Thank you very much for being here, or rather there, connected to listen to my conference talk. I would like to start by thanking the organizer of this important conference, and I would also like to address a special thanks to Massimo Leone for allowing me to participate in this FACET panel, even if I'm not directly involved in its research activities. This consideration allows me to introduce my research, which is being developed in the framework of a Marie Curie project entitled IMACTIS, Fostering Critical Identities Through Social Media Archival Images. This project is focused on the study of identity-related images on social network and shares with facets an eminent interest in the semiotic role of the face. So my intervention will consist in three basic thematic blocks. First of all, I would like to introduce my research by talking about its central hypothesis, which is based on a semiotic interpretation of recurse theory of identity.
Okay, one announcement, please. I would ask all the people who are in the panel to kindly switch off their microphones. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Remo. Secondly, I will focus on the relationship between the face and images, comparing the tool of visual semiotics with the framework proposed by Hans Belting in Face and Mask, A Double History. Finally, I will present two fields of analysis of social networks where is deployed what I call a dramaturgy of the face, although in light of Belting's hypothesis, we could rather call it a dramaturgy of face masks. As far as my research is concerned, it is based on a reinterpretation of Paul Ricoeur's theory of identity and its application to social networks. In his now classic book, Oneself as Another, Ricoeur conceives of identity as a dynamic core composed of two interrelated polarities. On the one hand, there is the identity idem, which includes instinctive dispositions, character traits, the body understood in its typical dynamism, and habits. Overall, the identity idem is composed of the set of traits that allow us to recognize a person as the same and which incorporate his invariable and static core. On the other hand, the identity ipse pertains to the behavioral identity, the ethical values chosen to build a lasting conduct, the heroic figures underlying one's own transformation, and the innovative habits adopted to reprogram it. In order to manage this complex relationship between the two polarities of identity, it is necessary to build a narration that combines them together in a lasting unity. It is the narrative intelligence of a story that allows us to fill the interval of meaning that separates these two polarities. Ricoeur identifies the construction of identity as a critical appropriation of the models of verbal storytelling, particularly those of literature. It is precisely thanks to a critical appropriation of the literary model of narration that it is possible to apply fabulation to life and to give identity a durable, meaningful, and flexible form. This theoretical model allows us to identify the tension to which identity is exposed on social networks. On the one hand, identity is confronted with renewed experiential pressure. The strong presence of simple images, which limit themselves to showing the presence of an individual on different occasions, think of selfies, and which are poorly articulated at a discursive level, are a clear example of this experiential pressure. Even the acts of liking, following, and sharing, which are at the basis of the constitution of collectives, reveal a sphere of a basic semiotic interaction, close to our character dispositions. For this reason, it is possible to situate this experiential regression as pertaining to the sphere of identity idem. On the other hand, the way in which our behavior is analyzed and modeled by algorithms pertains to the sphere of the identity ipse. We can think of the way in which Facebook recommends friends on the basis of our current circle of acquaintances, the way in which Netflix recommends personalized viewing schedules based on what we have previously watched and enjoyed, and even the way Tinder and Grindr recommend sexual and romantic partners on the basis of the face and profiles we have liked. This system of behavior modeling and of proposing recommendations can be understood as entailing a risk of progressive delegation of the identity ipse to an algorithmic intelligence. In order to manage these two pressures, experiential and algorithmic, it is necessary to build, as Ricora stated, an identity narration that can critically articulate them. The fundamental difference, however, lies in the model of appropriation required to achieve this process. It is no longer a question of literary models, but of models capable of physical displaying identities. In other words, we need to address models belonging to the languages of image, starting with the forms of the portrait up to other practices capable of visual structuring a narration, such as audiovisual story, television production, games narrative, and so on. Our hypothesis is that every image builds a negotiation between these two pressures, even if it's skewed towards one of the two poles. It is clear that identity narration on social network exploits the body and in particular the face in a privileged manner. In his book, Face and Mask, A Double History, Belting proposes a series of enlightening considerations that allow us to describe the face as a semiotic device. To summarize, we may say that Belting gives a central role to the dynamism of facial mimicry, to the plastic appearance of the face animated over time. What interests me is the relationship between the dynamism of mimicry and the production of particular expression, which Belting frames by means of two metaphors. On the one hand, the face produces masks, for example, to conceal and protect emotion and not let them transpire outwards. On the other hand, and more profoundly, Belting argues that the face is a plastic device that composes images. I would like to point out a strong correspondence with the expressive system of images. Authors such as Jean-François Bourdron have rightly pointed out that the meaning system of images cannot be traced back to verbal predication, precisely because images signify in a completely different way. Like faces, images do not predicate, but rather compose. Another interesting aspect of this relationship concerns the centrality of perceptual mechanism in the semiotization of images and face. In both images and face, recognition is a fundamental semiotic mechanism. It is the recognition of such or such specific trait, for instance, a particular configuration of fear or of a particular shade of yellow that counts, and not the categorical generality of the concept of yellow or fear. What this parallelism allows us to do is to identify the way in which image configuration and face configuration are stabilizing on social media compared to past representations of the face. First of all, as far as still images are concerned, we need to recall how the classical genre of the portrait resolves the tension between the compositional qualities of the face and the compositional qualities of images. Belting rightly tells us that the portraits stand in relation to the face as an externalized and objectified mask on a support, which makes it a durable, transportable object, but which inevitably erases the temporal dynamic character of mimicry. Two aspects are of particular interest to us. The first concerns the way in which the visual mask relate to the identity of the person represented. Anne B.R. Gelan and Maria Giulia Dondero, who have carried out some of the most important semiotic studies on the subject, insist on the iconization of the character of the individual, which is summed up, condensed, and best presented in the portrait. The portrait must be capable of condensing the subject's past, present, and future, capturing his or her identity and destiny in a single image. For this reason, in classical pictorial portraits, the objects and the background often build a narration capable of harmonizing the visual aspect of the character, which are the trait of the identity them expressed by the face, with visual elements pertaining to the subject conduct and thematic role, that is, the identity ipse as may be expressed by effigies, professional or rank object. In short, a classical portrait is a unique image turned towards the future in accordance with a memorial temporality capable of iconizing a narration identity within a fixed images. We can compare this model to the selfie and more generally to identity-related images that circulate on social network. The major differences are linked to the temporal dimension and to the various identity dynamics. Social networks shot are images that do not aim at iconizing and condensing a character within a single shot, but rather build a repeated series of shots that pluralize identity, fragment it, and reenact it in different contexts. The temporality of production and reception constitute a pellicular temporality, which develops itself in close proximity to the act of visualization and sharing. In other words, it is not a question of building a visual narrative that can summarize the life of an individual, but a theatricalization of the face in accordance with the management of the present of the self. With respect to recourse consideration, we could say that while the portrait aimed to build a narrative elaboration of the overall identity, idem and ipse, social network portraits are often a simple exhibition and multiplication of the identity idem. In an article submission for the scientific journal Semiotica, I propose an analysis of the Instagram profile of Rupi Kaur, a Canadian poet and influencer of Indian origin, from the beginning of her activities until today. I was able to identify the change in style from a casual use of her portraits to a competitive planned exploitation of her images. In other words, I try to describe the process of transformation from a casual user to an influencer. In this analysis, I found a wide variety of deformations of the portrait genre, some of which may be seen in contemporary photographic art, including turning one's back to the camera, the use of veils and atmospheric occlusion, but also fragmented portraits, which are typical of social network, as noted by Leif Manovich in its Instagram book. The second comparison I would like to present concerns video production and more generally those images capable of exhibiting the dynamic mimicry of the face. It is the actor character nucleus in film, but also in theater, that constitutes the most emblematic case. As pointed out by Belting, the theatrical actor builds images and more specifically masks through his face and builds a character thanks to mimicry skills. In semiotic terms, we could say that it is a peculiar process of débrayage, starting from the overall articulation capabilities belonging to his own face and body. The actor projects a selection of emotional and mimicry features that constitute the identity of the fictional character. One aspect of this transformation strikes me as important, the filtering role of the script. The script allows us to find a peculiar articulation of the identity poles defined by Ricoeur. The actor certainly projects some of the character traits belonging to his identity, but these remain embedded in his person. The actor therefore lends part of his identity idem dispositions to the fictional character. The fictional character, on the contrary, is a narrative identity, one already endowed with a closed path of transformation with values of departure and arrival. The mimetic projection of the actor together with the narrative mediation of the script allow to build this transformation in which the face and the body of a person builds a rich, dynamical and narrative identity. We could qualify this process as the donning of a fictional mask by the actor worn on the face. We can relate the actor character to the most representative and emblematic figure on social network, that is the influencer. What these two figures have in common is that they owe their success to their public image and, if we take streamers into account, to their mimicry identity. We will develop the comparison using an example shows for its clarity, that of horror video game streamers on the dedicated platform Twitch. Usually, these live broadcasts are organized as follows. The video game performance is displayed full screen with a virtual avatar moving the digital environment according to a text. In this case, the video game text, which is already organized narratively, but certainly in a less strict manner than a movie script may be, since it allows the expression of various styles of gameplay. On the right of the screen, we usually find the chat through which the audience can interact with the streamer. Most often, it is very short messages which are sent, mainly emoticons and peculiar forms of slang. Finally, a smaller window shows the face of the streamer who reacts live to the game performance and to the chat messages. Compared with the actor, the streamer does not project a character on the basis of his skills in terms of mimicry. On the contrary, he attempts to extract his identity character without prior programming and preparation. The filter is not that of a closed narration condensed into a script, but a playful script which organizes in a partly open way the mimic responses of fright, tension, exaltation, and so on. In other words, the narrative mediation provided by video game texts does not serve to build a narrative identity, but to extract a live character identity. It is no coincidence that this filter belongs to the macro genre of games, a practice by definition situated somewhere between lived experience and cultural construction. The character which emerges from this interaction does not use a narrative mask, but a playful socialized mask, whose purpose is precisely to embody its own identity idem, making it emerge dynamically within a partially structured experiential interaction. Compared to the case of the actor, the temporal dimension should again be emphasized. The performance of mimicry is strongly linked to the present moment, to the personality expressed naturally, with a visual direction that is limited to a fixed shot of his face. Reaction videos and children games channel replicate this formula and show us the peculiar way in which the link between images and faces increasingly tends to adhere to an identity close to genuine, instinctive, and contagious reaction. It is a matter of taking a song, a trailer, the execution of a cooking recipe as the basis for exhibiting through facial mimicry the visible expression of one's reaction during a first encounter with a widely known cultural product. To conclude, it is possible to say that social networks are characterized by a strong detachment from the fictional and narrative models advocated by Ricoeur. The identity models for social networks rather concern a management of visual presence over time, capable of exhibiting the identity idem in a manner that is as close as possible to actual experience. It is also possible to detect a second tendency, a narrowing of the strategy built on the languages of images in favor of the compositional qualities of the face, which multiplies the mask of presence thanks to the growing number of digital channels. As regards future line of research, it will be necessary to deepen the understanding of the relationship between the expressive quality of the face and of images. In particular, to identify other kinds of masks produced by faces within images. In addition to the iconizing mask of portraits, the multiple experiential mask of selfies, the fictional mask of the filmic or theatrical character, and the socialized playful mask of the influencer we have tried to describe. Thank you for your attention.